Film Companion gets you your film fix. Hit the bell icon and subscribe to get notified every time we drop a new video.
See why we don't watch content, same content, because we are content for each other.
Exactly. I always thought, okay, I'm going to do radio, then television, Comedy Central, and then movies. And then YouTube came along. So I say, okay, YouTube, television, then Amazon came along. Okay, so YouTube, Amazon, movies. So I guess next step is movies.
Hey guys, I'm so excited for my guests on today's episode of The Binge List. They're a pair of actors, comedians, writers, and creators who are among the coolest comedy creators around, who have built an amazing body of work, both together and apart, from sketches to shows like Better Life Foundation, to one of the most clutter-breaking and refreshing Indian streaming shows in Pushpavali. I'm talking, of course, about Naveen Richard and Sumukhi Suresh. Hi, Sumukhi, Naveen. It's wonderful to have you on The Binge List, so welcome.
Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. I thought I lost you after welcome, and I'm like, where, what?
Give them forewarning that one of our internets might stop, so that later on...
Oh, yeah.
You know.
It's a cliffhanger already.
Yeah. You don't know which one. You don't know which one of our internet is lagging, or are we playing a prank on you by freezing?
Just add my attention.
Yes.
But yes, no, it is really cool to have you here to discuss your shows, the stuff that you guys watch and how it's influenced you. And most of all, just to try and, you know, dissect this creative partnership. So I'm hoping it gets really emotional and somebody cries. That's the aim. But before we dive in to your shows, I really want to talk about, you know, start from the beginning and how you guys met. I believe it was years ago at an improv workshop in Bangalore. And so, you know, when you guys first met, what was it about each other that made you think that I can create some cool comedy with this person?
I don't think we thought that we could create comedy, but we did. I'll tell you my situation where I was like blown over. Was that 2-3 days, I think none of us noticed each other. At least I didn't. There was a whole exercise where you had to start by doing something, and then the other actor joins and mimes the same thing, and then you have to start the scene. Then that scene was just so good. I was like, wow, so cool. He made such a nice scene out of this. I was very like, wow, what a great guy.
I guess, I don't know what is in that scene that she saw, but this was Kanis's improv workshop, by the way. And I was actually blown away because I didn't know who Sumukhi was, but she started doing scenes with so much confidence. Like, she would walk into a scene and open a cupboard. And I'm like, I'm sorry, nobody taught us about an imaginary cupboard opening kind of thing. Where did you learn this? And she would just like walk into a scene, start ironing an imaginary iron. I'm like, excuse me, she seems like she's way ahead of us, because when we walk into a scene, we're all awkward. How does she know these things? And it turns out she's been doing improv already. And I like her confidence. But the reason we worked together is because Sumukhi and her friend Richard needed a male actor in their sketch group, because their old male actor would have ditched. And I was more than happy to do it. I'm like, all right, I just have to walk in and pick up the energy, I guess. Yeah. So I just walk in and yell some stuff, improvise, and We had one well-written sketch.
Yeah, one well-written, which was much later. Otherwise, we were, God knows what we were doing on stage.
And then I think we hit it off. I don't remember there being any awkward moments or anything like that. We were already warm. So Mukhi would finish her day job and show up on her Activa, like loaded with like sweaters and like jackets. And she'd show up in my house and we would write. Yeah, it was good fun.
And if those guys, those two from that improv workshop could see you guys today and all the cool stuff you've created, what do you think they'd say? You guys from 5 years ago, if you could see you today.
Oh. Yeah, no.
Wow, that's a good question.
Away into the distance.
Yeah.
No, those are the things that hit me. When I go back to Bangalore is when I realize, okay, we've done something. When I go back to Bangalore and I say, hey, that's the spot where Sumukhi and I used to write in the outside coffee day.
I don't know, actually. I don't know. I don't know how to react. Would you have told me, oh, Naveen and I would write Go Straight, Take Left? I don't think so. But then it doesn't surprise me. I'm just like, I don't know if that's what we would have predicted there. It wasn't like, this is the guy who I have the chemistry. No, it was nothing like that. Even sometimes both of us... Yeah, you know, literally, Naveen and I have long gaps, at least for me, where we don't perform, and then we come back together and we're like, oh, I guess, I don't know if we still have it in us.
Yeah.
And then I go, we still have it.
Yeah, yeah, I can get a little like nervous, especially, you know, it's been a long time since we wrote Ghost Ray, Take Love, a sketch show together. And then it took a while, right? Because we hadn't written anything together in a while. And we're like, I guess that's the end of our friendship, bro. But then it came again. Then it came again. We're like, whoo, we still got it.
Woo, thank God.
Yeah. Coming to your list of your favorite shows, you know, we tried to find a list of shows that, you know, really summarize the biggest influences on both of you, stuff that you both like. You agreed, some cases you didn't. But they're all very interesting choices. All comedy shows, but very, very different kinds of comedy. So starting with, you know, where it all started with you guys, which is sketch. You start with a British, iconic sort of British sketch show, which is a bit of Fry and Laurie, which you both said that you're a big fan of. It's, again, this is sort of big 90s British sketch show starring, you know, Hugh Laurie and Stephen Fry, these two big comedy legends. So was this the show that made you guys sort of first discover sketch comedy?
Well, Fry and Laurie isn't the first thing you start watching, but it's one of those things when you, like, you know, maybe the first things you watch are, you know, when you join a theater group, they make you do like some Rowan Atkinson sketches or Monty Python sketches and things like that. Nobody stumbles upon Fry and Laurie. And then suddenly, as you're on YouTube, you suddenly find this and be like, oh, what is this whole other? It seems so much more subtle and yet exaggerated and silly. And then you go down that rabbit hole. Yeah, so it's not the first thing you stumble upon.
Mine was a very chance. I don't know. I'm not a, it was very surprising. In fact, the first time we bonded on Fry and Laurie, I remember where, also I constantly surprised Naveen, because when I grew up, my content is mainly Hindi. So for me, all of these things came much later. Like my ex introduced me to Fry and Laurie. And I was like, oh shit, this is so funny. And then when Naveen and I were talking about it, Naveen's like, oh, okay.
Yeah. I guess. Nobody has watched Fry and Laurie.
He's watched more Fry and Laurie than I have, because I think the number of, like, he's watched also watched more content than me. So I maybe started watching Fry and Laurie in 2013 or something, or I don't know, at some point of 12, where my, I was trying to be like, oh, I also like English stuff like my ex. I was doing that.
Yeah. And you guys have a favorite sketch?
I think we were really influenced by their in-between segments, in-between the sketches. In some scenes, they'll just start reading letters from the audience. They'll plant some themselves in the audience. They'll start like breaking the fourth wall. This was a few seasons later. And we're like, oh, this is the kind of cool stuff that, you know, the in-betweens. And so we took our in-betweens very seriously.
Which didn't make it to the final show. Like when you came for the live show, you'd see the in-betweens. Like it's, we finish a sketch and then we go backstage and it looks like our mics are on and we're talking to each other backstage. So the sketch is, you know, technically the sketch is still going on. There's one sketch here and there's the parallel sketch of backstage. But we really tried hard to put it into the sketch.
So we needed something to kill time but while we changed, but we couldn't do the lines as we changed. So we recorded some stuff in my house and we would play it. And I don't know if people really believed it, but it was fun for them to hear this parallel storyline learning from backstage.
But that's genius. That's a great way to fill those gaps of getting changed and things.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And there's another part of the show that, remember we'd plant someone in the audience and get them to fight with us. And this is something they didn't make it to the final show.
Yeah.
But in every end of the show, we'd have someone in the audience. They'd start heckling us. And I would start a fight with them and they'd like call Sumuki names and then we'd slap each other and the entire audience would get uncomfortable and... So we would lose out on a standing ovation every time because we chose to end it on that weird note. But we were like, this is art, man. Nobody gets us.
You said in an interview that when you guys used to work on sketches, you know, you used to improvise on stage quite a lot. And Naveen used to be much more sort of by the words and by the writing. So is that true in overtime? Have you guys?
In the writing process, Naveen's like, yeah, go for it. But when it's on stage... I know we wrote it, but Naveen improvises as much, if not sometimes more. So like both of us are improv whores for sure. But during writing, he used to be the guy who used to be like, okay, let's put a structure together. You go crazy or if you want to. And he anyway has like a math in his head of how much to improvise to get a sketch down. So writing wise, Naveen's very strong. So Naveen is really like, okay, let's just improvise the scene and take how it goes. And then he takes... parts of it to make sure that, you know, there's a structure to it.
So Mookie is like the fireworks that, you know, there's the rocket which goes up and just blasts. So Mookie is like that 10 blasts in one and then it'll go pew, 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 and then it goes And that's a great bio. Yeah, I'm like, just put straight rock. People won't know where to look. It's not Diwali, okay? So make your jokes, try to go in one direction, otherwise it'll be too disconnected. But she is an explosive bunch of rock like that.
What do you guys feel that sketch gives you that stand-up doesn't?
Man, you get to have your friend up there. So you really, it's not as lonely and it's so much fun. Now, I don't know if a lot of stand-up comedians even realize what they're missing out on. Maybe they don't even want to do it. But when you've done sketch, you realize how much fun it is to have someone up there. I got a call, guys. Sorry. I came back. I got a call. Yeah, but when you're up there with someone, you have someone, you know, someone's got your back. Got someone else's back.
I feel like it's more at home. Like on stage, I'm more comfortable. I got more comfortable with the stage with sketches and improv. So stand-up was almost like a byproduct for me. A sketch and improv were the things or are the things which I'm most comfortable with. Stand-up, I'm like, okay, I guess.
And just coming to the next on your list, which isn't a single show. It's actually a debate between two massive shows. And so I figure it's time to sort of fight it out. Sanuki, you are Team Parks and Rec. And Naveen, you are Team The Office. So I feel like we need to sort of get to the bottom of this once and for all.
I mean, we like the other shows as well, by the way. She likes The Office.
I like The Office.
But which one do you
prefer
like?
Parks and Rec?
Oh, I like Parks and Rec more, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So obviously they're both great shows. They share a very similar DNA, you know, same creators, both that mockumentary style, both, you know, very celebrated shows. But yes, Sumuki, starting with you, why Parks and Rec? Why do you prefer that?
I'm just very partial to Amy Poehler. Like I started watching when Better Life Foundation, Naveen was writing with Hota and Navneet. He had told me that it's the whole universe of Office was introduced to me. And I didn't know about The Office. And I started watching, I think, one or two episodes. And simultaneously, I have a friend called Sandhya, who is a big Amy Poehler fan. So both of us used to jam about Amy Poehler and Tina Fey. And she's like, oh shit, if you're watching mockumentary, you gotta watch Parks and Rec. I was like, oh fuck, what is Parks and Rec? And then I just went crazy on Parks and Rec, but mainly because I'm just partial towards Amy Poehler. There's nothing else. Like, it's not like I don't like The Office. Even now, I just finished like 5-6 seasons again of The Office because it's The Office. But it just, if you tell me to pick, I'm like, it's Amy. Come on. Please.
Yeah. When I was watching The Office and then Parks and Rec came out, I really tried to get into it. It's the same reason I'm not a big fan of Brooklyn Nine-Nine as well. And I know I'm pushing many people's buttons with that. But it's just like, yeah, everybody tone it down just a little bit. Okay? I get it. Tone it a little bit. Don't get overconfident. I know you're funny, guys. Just tone it down. All right? And with Parks and Rec...
Brooklyn Nine-Nine is that. It's true.
And everybody in Parks and Rec is trying to get Michael Scott level of weird. But in The Office, only Michael Scott is Michael Scott level of weird. And he's like a weird guy in a normal world. Over there, everybody, even the extras are weird and things like that.
So you feel like The Office has more sort of iconic, memorable characters in Parks and Rec?
You know what? I like subtlety, but I'm not going to say I like so much subtlety that I like the British Office more than the American Office. Yeah. Okay. I know a lot of people are like, I like the British one more. I'm like, that's, you know, the lighting is just too tube light in that. And I'm like, you can brighten up. It doesn't have to be so depressing and subtle. I like the American Office because it's a little weird, but people are also controlling themselves. Unlike like the 8th season of The Office where everyone's dialed it up a bit. And that tends to happen when you've written that many seasons. You know, you figure out the formula. And once you figure out the formula, it seems formulaic. I like to watch the shows when they haven't figured out their formula yet. When they've been writing the seasons so close to each other that they're still a little unsure of themselves, and you can feel the hunger while you're watching the show.
I like Mr. It's just it's purely just a bias towards Amy Poehler. Honestly, there's nothing.
But you love Veep though. She's a big Veep person, right? Yeah.
I literally just rewatched the season again.
Because
Julia Louis-Dreyfus, because she's just.
I watched Veep because you loved it so much.
I wish I could be her. I will.
Seasons. Yes, you would. You kind of are, and you will be. Even more, perhaps, per chance, if time permits. And Veep is also one of those, it's like in fast forward. And it's very cool. And it's like a machine gun of jokes and timelines. And that's a lot for me. And I'm like, you know, another show which is clever and full of jokes is Arrested Development, but it doesn't feel that fast.
Yeah. It's true. It is. Veep is very put. But also, it's because it matches my pace of talking because I go very. So I'm very like, oh, okay. Yeah, you guys are fast. I'm also fast. Come. So it's all that true. Again, partiality for Julia Louis-Dreyfus. Like, come on, guys.
Veep 30 Rock was also full of like, 30 Rock is also the right, I think, pace. Full of jokes.
Yeah.
And also, there also everyone's walking. Everyone's walking. But it's the right pace for me, yeah.
And but I think one show that we can all agree on in this space is the one that, you know, Parks and Rec and The Office both inspired, which is Better Life Foundation. But Naveen, technically you created that show. It also happens to be one of my favorite comedy shows, if I'm allowed to chime in.
Thank you.
But Sumukhi, you know, you acted in it. So did you write that part for Sumukhi? How did that come about?
Yep, pretty much straight up just for her, man. I mean, when we pitched the show, it was just like a two-line pitch. When you're like, a couple of do-good social workers trying to make the world a better place, something, except for the something of their bumbling accountant. And I think I'm pretty sure the bumbling accountant is the part that sold the show. And then when they bought the show, we're like, okay, now we have to get down to business. And I was like, well, I guess it's... I knew that it's easy to write. I'm like, because technically you're supposed to sit and, you know, when they write for a character, you're supposed to see their background and like, all these questions you're supposed to answer. I'm like, listen, we don't have time for this. I know Sumukhi and I kind of know how she is. And I, you know, I kind of base it off that. But Sumukhi is one person I knew right from the beginning that I wanted in this show because we'd already acted together.
And was making that show as fun as it was to watch? Was it...
It was a lot of fun, man. It was a lot of fun. Like, I mean, there was also, of course, like the moments of, I agree. But as an actor who was on set, both the seasons were so much fun because the comics that are majorly comics on set. And that's always fun because somebody or the other is trying to be funny or is funny or is doing something or the other. As an actor, it was just a lot of fun. BLF, both seasons. In fact, Naveen may, as a writer or as a creator, may have been like, I constantly be like, is there another season? Because, you know, and also Sumukhi Chawla is my favorite character, especially the time when Naveen asked me to play that was when I just used to get mom roles or I used to get like domestic help roles. I was like, can I stop wearing a sari for a role? And then BLF came. So I'm very grateful and happy for that character.
Yeah, also. And then you got stuck also, dude, just love it.
Great.
Now you're back.
Semi-karate.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Thank God.
And we have to talk about your recent Instagram upload where, you know, you put out this very sort of hilarious and sincere video to Disney Plus asking them if they can, because obviously they have the rights to season two, but obviously it's not on that platform anymore. Mm-hmm. And it was obviously driven by the fans because there are so many diehard fans who, you know, ask you every day about accessing season two. So do you hope something can come from it?
You know, I hope so. I really do hope so. Because I've moved on and I have the show with me whenever I want to watch it, I probably don't appreciate the show as much as the fans probably do. I don't know. And I think they make me realize that, okay, hey, listen, you put in 8 months. They don't really, I mean, for me, it's just like a black hole in time that 8 to 9 months where we sat and wrote it, but the fans keep asking so I really hope it comes back because it was good, man. There were good times. It's good times we had on set. And you don't realize what you're missing till you watch those things again. Until then, I guess people have to make do with a blooper reel on YouTube.
We'll take what we can get.
Yeah.
Well, but it really is, I think, one of the best comedy shows that's come out, you know, in India, in the streaming space. It's an area we haven't seen too much experimentation on. I really think it's such a wonderful show. And you miss these characters. So I hope Disney Plus Hotstar caves and gives us access to season two again.
Thank you, man.
I'm guessing there's no show that's impacted you guys or influenced you as much as one that you've created together. So we have to talk about Pushpavali. And I mean, it really still is, I think, one of the most refreshing and clutter-breaking shows we've seen in India so far. I think the first question the fans would kill me to ask is, do we know when we can expect season three?
Shit. I was hoping I'll get stuck now.
Now, alright. We just freeze.
I'm not sure. I'm very unsure about if we will have a season three or not. And also, I think with after season two, all of us have also realized that if it comes, cool. If not, I think personally or individually, we are doing other stuff. We're creating more stuff. We want to create more characters. Yeah, but if it comes back, we'll also be okay with that. Be like, oh yeah, okay, let's get back together on that. So like the urgency that we had for season two, at least I had, where I was like, I want a season two. There was a lot more to prove. That urgency is not there for season three, because we're like, we know how we left season two. So even if you don't give us the season three, everyone's going to get fucked if you watch season two. I'm just going to be like, oh shit, who died? So I'm like, oh, that's a great cliffhanger to leave everyone. But we also don't know. And
we really don't
know. I think
know.
All
I
of like us are very like, I guess, yeah.
Yeah, we're like, if it comes, it'll be fun. I mean, we always look forward. I mean, I have much more fun working on Pushpavali than on BLF, because BLF, because you know, you feel the weight on your shoulders. Pushpavali, the weight is on her. So I just get to come in and do some math and solve some problems and figure out the structure, do the dialogue, which is the most fun part.
Oh, dialogue's so much fun, yeah.
And even on the set, I tried, you know, I get to do as much fun stuff as I want and contribute. And so it's fun like that. So I'm ready.
Do you remember where it all started? Did sort of Sumukhi come to you one day and said, look, I want to make a funny show that's also dark, that's about love and stalking. Let's do it.
Please. If you feel like it's very lighthearted ways of Sumukhi asking, it's never. I, in fact, my whole pitch was that, oh, there's a girl who moves cities to stalk a boy. And... you know, she's obsessed with him. And that was the thought that I always had. In fact, we had earlier drafts where I think we were another set of writers, Sumaira, me, and I think two other writers. We wrote a few drafts, which was very shit. And which I think at that time, I wasn't aware of the whole classic rule of all your initial drafts are shit. But yeah. I think somewhere the thought was right, but there was just the screenplay was all over the place and the tone was not right. We didn't have the right tone. And I think the time, Naveen at that time was in the US and he came back just in time for the reading. And it was such a horrible reading. I have never tanked in my life so much, and Naveen was in it. And I think at that evening, I was like, if you please clear a month out and just please come and fix, help me fix the show. And he truly came in, and season one was heavily saved by Naveen. He came in and he gave a lot of direction and thought and a sort of a structure to the story. By the time, I think we rewrote the show in like, what, 23 days? And then
yeah,
as
the
we were prepping for production, we were like, okay, fuck it, let's fix jokes again. So,
yeah.
My character was not even fleshed out when we had written the draft.
You didn't even want to play the main character, huh? By the way, remember? You were like, wanted to play one of the PG girls and stuff. And you were like,
oh, yeah.
No, bro. You play this main character, whatever her name is.
What are the strangest responses you guys have had from people about the show? Has anyone ever said, that's me, that's my story?
Oh, God. Daily basis. We were very surprised. We didn't think that, you know, when we were writing out Pushpavali and playing it out, none of us thought that she's relatable. Like, she's crazy, but I wasn't sure that she's relatable. And we were okay with that, because she's not a mainstream, whatever, positive reinforcement to any sort of a character. So on a daily basis, very like, I relate to her so much. Maybe not that crazy, but still that crazy. I was like, you know, that means you're crazy. Which is crazy. So it's very, yeah, no, which is very surprising. I think all of Pushpavali's response is surprising for me, at least, because I remember when it was released, I was with Debbie outside OML. I was like, I just hope 100 people watch it. We were very surprised with the response.
Yeah, we just wanted it not to suck.
Yeah, we didn't want it to suck. We were like, nobody should watch it and be like, this is why comics shouldn't act, or this is why comics shouldn't write. I just
also because we sit and judge other shows so much, we were like, what if we are many people, we are pointing fingers, many fingers are pointing at us situation. We don't want it to be that.
Very true.
Yeah.
Oh, I think I know other people personally who love that show, so I can confirm that it really did land successfully. But just, you know, when you're acting both your characters, you know, especially in the finales, it really does go to some very sort of serious territory. So does it make you as actors want to explore drama more?
I know that both of us have this thing of both of us like acting. So I know that this was, you know, it's almost like I know that at any point, whatever I'm going to create, I want to keep him in mind, because I know we like acting and people still look at us as comics and not as actors. So we may not get an opportunity that someone else might get. So if it's going in the drama side, we may not be worried. We will just be like, I hope we do justice to it rather than, you know, make it like a weird ham, which is...
Yeah, I don't think we'll ever go full drama. I think we're incapable of it. I think of just staying drama, because we inherently can't help but see the and poke fun at things and laugh at misery sometimes. So, but then we both know that, yeah, even if, whether it's a movie that we write or whatever it is, it's going to have some drama as well because it's nice. It's nice. Those moments, yeah, you know what? That's the challenge. Put the drama in is challenge. And when we get it right, when we're editing and we put the music in, and then when people in the room get emotional, I start laughing because I'm like, oh my God, they fell for it.
Oh, every time. You know, the screening happened at my house because Corona was in it. And I remember people were like, wow, so and Navina, like, what's happening?
You get cringed out even though that's what you wanted in the first place.
Drama is, for me, is fun because, you know, drama gets very different range out of it. I love drama because things around me are too dramatic, I feel. So, yeah, for sure. But he's
right.
Yeah,
she got the drama scenes out of me. So, Mukhi, I'm so glad that she made me do this and the role that I played because, it's not something I would have otherwise done. But she encouraged me to do that and it was really fun. Yeah.
And Naveen, you know, you said that the best part about writing, you know, a show like this with your friend is that, you know, you're not overthinking it. You know, the aim is really just to make each other laugh. And if you know that if you make the other person laugh, it's working. And you're almost writing it for each other, not for anybody else, which I thought was wonderful. So is that how you know that something is working? Just because if you get the other person to crack up, you know, you've got something.
Yeah, exactly. It helps. That's why I say when you're in a writer's room, putting people that you would otherwise normally hang out with. She's stuck. I would say putting people that you normally hang out with because you can trust them with the joke. Well, you know, because audiences, yes, you have to make it for the audience as well. But sometimes an audience will watch your show and laugh and they'll watch another show that you don't like as much and they'll laugh as well. So you're like, you can't trust them 100%. But you know your friend and your wavelength is the same. So that way your bar, you can trust your friend with the bar. And but with something like Pushpavali, you know, the thing is once you get to a second season, especially with a Pushpavali, you feel a little bit of pressure. So you're not just like, all right, let's just do this for ourselves. We suddenly realize, okay, this is a bit of the target audience. A little bit of that stuff comes. Suddenly the platform will get a little bit more involved. They'll be like, all right, you know that some of these things work. So we're like, all right, here comes the formula. Here it comes. Yeah.
And just lastly, you know, you guys worked together for the longest time and hopefully we'll carry on doing so. If there's one thing you could sort of steal from the other person, one sort of talent that you could take from Naveen or Naveen could, you know, you could take from Smokey, what would it be?
I would like that every once in a while I can be the kind of fireworks box that she is, which is just exploding in all directions. Quick, go! Like a reliable fireworks box that, you know, when you light it or even when you don't light it, it's just going to blow up everywhere and entertain everyone for large distances. Sort of
bursting with ideas, basically.
Bursting, not holding back, and I wish that I had that switch. Yeah,
I don't think Sumukhi wants anything from you. She's pretty much dropped off at this point. So just take.
I wish she had my intimate. Yeah,
guys, I think I can see you. I'm not. You're back. Yeah, sorry. Yeah. What is the question? What is the answer? Sorry, I'll be quiet now.
What is the color of my eyes?
Black.
Brown.
Shit, brown.
I said, if there was one talent you could take from Naveen, what would it be?
One talent that Naveen would have. Well, Naveen's writing sensibility. I think he's an extraordinary writer. His natural gut feel for good content, for good jokes is too good. So you can trust him you can fight with him, but you can also at some point trust him for being like, no, this is not going to work. And invariably it doesn't work. So, you know, that sense of gut feel, which you develop, of course, naturally being who he is, and also the fact that he's watched so much content and he understands how content works. That cannot be spread. Like, as much as I would be like, I would want that, it takes time. So, like, I cannot fast forward that sensibility in 3-4 years. So, I wish I had that.
Thank you so much. This was so much fun to do. I'm so glad.
So sorry for our
interrupts. It's fine. We all have the same problem. But no, I'm glad we managed to do it, and I'm glad I got to talk to you guys about the stuff that, you know, how you've influenced each other, the stuff that's influenced you guys. And just as a fan, I hope you guys keep creating really, really cool stuff together. So fingers crossed.
Thank you, Sachin. Thank you for liking our stuff and giving us good reviews and following our stuff. You've always been really sweet, man. Thank you. Hello, viewer. If you like this video with Sumukhi, Suresh and I, then you know what to do.
Please like, share, and subscribe to Film Companion's beautiful YouTube channel. Press the bell icon so that you can get new notifications. And say hi to Suchin.
Goodbye.
Yeah.